Good morning. It's good to see everybody this morning. My name is Jon Exman. I'm the senior pastor here. If you're here for the first time, we're glad to have you worshiping here with us. If you're watching online for the first time, we're also glad to have you being a part of our worship service this morning. There's a couple of announcements I wanted to give. One is we started back the two pastor Bible studies. The one is tomorrow night at the Downing House at 6:30. And that's the one that Pastor Carter will be leading. Then the one that I lead is on Wednesday mornings at 11 o'clock in the Pears and Spares room. You can come to that one. We're into Matthew on Wednesday, and we're in Acts on Monday. So you can go to both of them, too, if you'd like. That's great also. Tonight, the youth are going to be meeting again, but I don't think you're having your Christmas stuff yet. You're getting close to it, though, I think. They're eventually going to have Christmas. I don't know what's going to happen, but we're glad that they can get back together. And also, I saw this morning coming in, but I didn't get a chance to say hi to him yet. I saw the Englands back there in the back, and we're glad to have both of you guys here with us again. We had missed you. I'm going to ask Pam to come up here. She had an announcement of a group that she wanted to start, and it was up on the screen, but she wanted a chance to be able to say a few things about it, and I'll let her do that.
Good morning. Great to see everybody here today. We are starting something new here at Central Trinity, so if you haven't read it or seen it online, I wanted to let you know that I was approached recently by the Mental Health Recovery and Services Board, and they asked me if I would be willing to lead a support group for those who have lost someone to suicide. I lost my son 26 years ago to suicide, and there's three things that really helped me get through that. One is our love and grace of God. I don't know where I'd be without him. And in addition to that, a lot of therapy, but also the support group. And the support group provided a safe place to come and to talk and to share those experiences that people have when they go through this. So I want to extend an invitation to you. If you have lost someone to suicide or you know someone, go ahead and have them come. It's going to be the first Thursday of every month, and it's the first group meeting is this Thursday. It's in the Strong Family classroom, so I invite you to come. Thank you.
Thank you, Pam. Appreciate you sharing that, and appreciate you listening to God's call and doing that too as well for our church and for yourself and for others. Thank you. Any other announcements that I'm missing? Yes. Oh, that's right. Rick Mueller was telling us that we were having a little bit of computer issues, and we've been trying to fix it. And so if you've been trying to get your end of the year statement, we don't have that yet. Not all the dots are connected yet to make that work. So we're working hard to fix that, and hopefully very soon we'll be able to have all those for you, because usually by tomorrow we usually have those for everybody. And so we apologize for that, and we're working on it. We had a computer guy even coming in just this week. So any other announcements or things? All right. Well, we'll go ahead and have our call to worship this morning and begin our service together.
Thank you. Good morning, Central Trinity. Our opening hymn today can be found on page 384, Love Divine, All Loves Excelling. We will sing verses 1, 2, and 4. Would you please stand? Would you please remain standing for our Apostles' Creed? I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Be seated. At this time, I'll ask our children's choir members to come on up.
feel good
to know He is there.
To know He is there.
I am His lamb.
I am His lamb.
Safe in His care.
Safe in His care.
He is watching over.
Watching over His sheep.
And it makes me so happy to know. At this time, children are dismissed to Kids Zone Worship. Our prayer hymn this morning can be found on page 395. Take time to be holy. We will sing verse 1.
We'll take just a few moments here to share together. Before we have our silent prayer, are there any prayer requests that we'd like to share this morning? Yes. Okay. Marcy's son, Brett, going to have neck surgery. Any others? All right. As I said, it's always good when we see people feeling a little better and getting back in here with us. And I shared about the Englands. And are there any others that I didn't catch that I haven't been here in just a little bit? All right. I try really hard to look. So go ahead and take a few moments then in silent prayer, and then we'll pray together. Heavenly Father, we give you praise and we give you glory for all the things that you do in our lives. Thankful this morning of hearing the kids as they sing and the teenagers as they're about to share as well. And just to see the love of the Lord written on their faces as they sing and give a word of love and grace to each of us. What a special thing that is to be able to take part in. What a great time that is for the church that we're able to give those moments to you. We thank you, Father, for all the ways that you continue to be there for us, to lift us up, to share with us, to help us to grow. And we ask, Father, for those moments too where we share and as we look for growth and as maybe we don't necessarily hear your word immediately at the moment that we would like, help us to spend time and keep praying, waiting for that opportune moment as we hear from you and hear from your word that you have for each of us. We thank you for these things, Father. We ask that you watch over the health of our congregation and those that are traveling and going different places, and watch over the new groups that are getting started, such as this grief group, and be with it, Father. And we ask that you put your hand upon it, put your hand upon Pam as she leads it. Watch over all these things as we come together this morning and as we pray the prayer that your son taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you.
Thanks, kids. We appreciate hearing from you guys, and got to hear from the little ones and see their faces as they sang, and see the teenagers as they, or almost teenagers, most of them, as they sing too as well. makes you remember things, because, you know, as the saying goes, time stops for nothing, right? Those of you that have had kids or have grandkids or nieces, nephews, whatever it is that you have at a younger age, you know that the time just keeps on coming, doesn't it? Just keeps on rolling by. I was struck as I was standing there watching my son sing, how when he was, let's see, he went out of here, didn't he? All right, so I won't get yelled at for talking about him. but he, I can remember when he was younger, he loved to mimic whatever songs or things that we were watching on television. One of his favorites was the Chitty Chitty Bang Bang, and he would do the different parts of Chitty Chitty Bang Bang. And so I was standing here watching him sing and thinking about when he was 2, 3, and 4 and singing that too as well. So time flies, doesn't it? Right? Next thing you know, they're all grown up and out of the house, or next thing you know, we're all grown up and getting older too as well. How many times do we take just a moment and each day, and you know, it's strange because for some of us, that's a difficult thing, but yet what do we do in our house for decorations? We put all these different mirrors up, and then we walk past, and we say, hey, who's that guy? Who's that girl? Who is that that's walking there? That doesn't look anything at all like what I remember. And what happens, right, is that in our mind's eye, we think of who we are, what we look like, and maybe even in our head, we're still thinking that we're 21, 22, and out on the prowl, right? Maybe. You never know. And then the next thing you know, you're getting a little older. Time's passed you by. It's a little harder to get up from the chair. You got to make noises as you get up or sit down. I don't know why. Who ever started that rule that when you get older, you have to release noise whenever you stand up or sit down? It's just a natural thing that happens. We watch our grandparents or mom or dad do that, and we just naturally want to do it too. If you do not do it, good for you, because you're not giving in to that thing. But I know that once I hit about 47 or 48, I started doing those things myself, and it just happens. But time, we've been talking about God's voice and the power of God's voice and the different ways that God's voice comes to us. And one of those ways is time. We have a certain amount of time on earth, right? The average age for each of us is in the late 70s is the last time I looked. I don't think it's up into the 80s yet, but the average age is about, it's a little higher now. Maybe 78 to 80, around in there, because we got a lot of, how many over 80 in here do we have today? Well, see, you're keeping good time, right? You're ready to roll. And some of you are more active probably than the rest of us, and we're glad for that. But we've got all these things that we do to try to keep our time and keep it at bay and keep us going. And we say things like, you know, time stops for no one. Or we say, it doesn't matter the time or the age. It's how you feel, right? Well, time is a big part of our faith, too, as well. And there's so much about time in Scripture that we can look at. In fact, if we're looking at just the word time, the Greek for time actually occurs in a lot of different places, but it occurs with two words. One is chronos, and the other is kairos. And that's the two parts of time that occur in Scripture. Chronos, you can imagine, is that word that gets included in some of our words that we use related to time even now, like chronological, right? Or something to that effect. And kairos, so chronological is that time, that regular time, where it goes, from daylight to darkness and just normal related time things. But kairos, when that word is in place in Scripture, it actually refers to those opportune times. And it's a capturing of moments. In Ephesians, the verses that we're going to read right here, kairos is used in the place of this. And it's almost like our spiritual promptings. That's like what kairos is like compared to chronos. And the scripture that we're going to start off with is Ephesians 5, 13 through 16. And this is what it says. But everything exposed by the light becomes visible, and everything that is illuminated becomes a light. This is why it is said, wake up, sleeper, rise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you. Be very careful, then, how you live, not as unwise, but as wise, making the most of every opportunity, because the days are evil. Now, why did I choose that for something related to time? And if you don't mind, John, if you want to leave 13 up there, I'll kind of go through it here in just a second. Now, we know that time related to God, God is omnipresent, right? Meaning that he's everywhere. He's a part of every moment and a part of everything, no matter what it is that we do. That's what he is about. He's not bound by anything in time or space, right? Because he created it. So therefore, time, actually, even though we think it's ours, it's his, because it was something that he created. We know from Scripture that he said, let there be light. There was light. And he went through all the different parts of Scripture and organized them for us, but it was in his time. But somehow over the years, it's become about us and less about him. And so what happens is we ask for something and we want it now. We didn't want it then. We want it now. And that even happens when we have things in life that make things happen faster than they used to, right? How many of you remember a period of time when there were no microwaves? That's most of us, right? Maybe some of our younger ones are sitting there and thinking, no microwaves? What was that? So you had to cook everything on the oven or on the stove, in the oven or on the stove, right? And then what happens is if you wanted to heat something up, you had to what? Preheat your oven or your stove so that you could get whatever it was heated up. And so time was of the essence when you were making meals or getting things ready, and you had to be prepared for that. And so next thing you know, and I'm not really sure exactly, I forgot to look up and see when was the exact time period that the microwave first came about, but how many of you remember then when you started seeing in some of the homes or people that you went and visited and there was a microwave present and you looked at it and it was almost like evil, right? You were like, what is that thing? And it's buzzing. It's giving off gamma waves, microwaves, who knows, whatever. I'm going to turn into the Incredible Hulk and something bad's going to happen. Right? Did you think that? No? I bet some of you did. Because how often did you maybe have a child in your house and what they did is they were mesmerized by what was happening in the microwave and they stuck their face right up in it and watched it. And then you were like, no, don't do that. But even now, microwaves are more powerful they go faster than ever before. Things can defrost faster than ever before. Things can be cooked faster. And so we use them, but we still stand in front of them impatiently waiting for it to be finished, right? Forgetting the fact that a few years before that, we didn't even have that there to do. We had to stand there in front of the stove. And so that's the way things work regarding time. Time is frustrating often. Time is hard as we try to figure out time between who we are and who God is, because Scripture tells us in the 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 8, with the Lord, one day is like 1,000 years. Wow, that's a big difference, isn't it? So the day that we go from and we say, boy, this day seemed like it took forever. Actually, it did. It was long, right? Because God says, it's my time, not your time. So when you worry about it, you're missing out on the other parts of time. You're thinking in Chronos time when I want you thinking in Kairos time. And that Kairos time is those opportune moments. And we should always live in those opportune moments, looking for them, seeking them, trying to find them out and saying, when is that next moment going to occur for us? And it's those special God moments where anything can happen. All right, now so you understand it. Again, Chronos means the chronology of days governed by the way the earth rotates. God himself made those measurements. Kairos is more like if you're a photographer or you've ever had a series of important pictures, maybe a wedding or a family get-together. The photographer said, if we're going to do pictures outside, we have to wait for that golden hour, that magic hour, right? That time when the lights hit just right and the pictures then become just right. That's Kairos, the magic time, the moment in the schedule when time ceases being just a time, but it becomes something even more. We define it sometimes like this. We're in a season. Right? Right now, we're in a season of time unlike any other that we've ever had in quite a long time in history. I don't believe there's probably any of us old enough to remember the last time that the world kind of shut down because of diseases or things. Maybe you do, some of you. But mostly, we just keep going, right? We plow through time no matter what. But instead, quite a few months ago, we were told to stop time, right? And we were told in order to make something go away or be alleviated, what we want you all to do is stop the different parts of time that you have in your life and stay at home, right? And we did that, most of us. There were some of us that were deemed essential people that needed to do things in order to make the world keep going. Anybody in here that did not have to, like, kind of shelter in place at your home? A couple of you. And we appreciate that. Appreciate your service. But for the rest of us, we were told, hey, stay at home, and then maybe we can curb this, and something good will happen. Now, I don't know about you, but for the first part of that, in the Exman household, it kind of seemed almost like a party or a vacation, right? You were like, stay at home? Yes. I'll stay at home. I'll sleep in. I'll do whatever I want. I'll cook some things, do some things. About the, what, fourth, fifth, sixth, seventh day? Some of us, maybe the second week or the third week or whatever. And you started to get a little bit crazy because time was slipping away and you were a time-oriented person and it was virtually impossible for you to sit still any longer. And so what you started doing was is bothering the heck out of the rest of the people in your household, right? How many of you were the ones then that said, okay, since we have all this time, everybody out in the garage, we're going to rearrange it and reorganize, right? Willard, I know Sharon probably said, Willard, get up there in the attic and fix some of the things that you got there and get those straightened, I know. Then all those things were happening, right? Then that time kind of got taken away. Because you did it all. And the next thing you know, you're sitting again. And I don't know about your house. Maybe if you were by yourself, it became even harder. But if you had some of your family or your kids that had to shelter with you, what began to happen is that time had slowed down to almost like another period of time that we all lived in, where we spent most of the day together. There's a few instances that I've talked to families that have said, hey, you know what? I didn't mind that spending time at home because we did things as a family that we haven't done in a long time. We played cards. We played board games. We played tricks on each other. We did all these different things that we used to do when the kids were younger that we hadn't had a chance because they were so busy or we were so busy. And then time changed again. Through it all, though, God's saying to us, there's a season for everything, a time and a place for everything. Right before what we read, that's what Ephesians says. There is a time and a place for everything under heaven. And each opportune moment has been designed for this. And whatever this is, that's what we are to figure out. And it happens through the voice of the Lord. The voice of the Lord calling out to you and saying, figure out what time it is. Figure out the time it is that you have right now. And here's what I want you to do. We know some of the key Kairos moments in biblical time. One of them we're about to spend time on a journey to here in a few weeks during the Lenten season, and it's the cross. That's a key Kairos kind of time. It's a moment where Romans 5:6 says, for while we were still helpless, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly, for those who don't believe. He died for you and for me. And that Kairos time is a special moment because it's a moment that we should share with each and every person that we meet. But the problem is that our time is so full of everything else that we don't take then the time to share. I was talking with one or two of our church people earlier this week. It might have been the end of last week. And they said, I noticed that these last few Sundays you're talking about witnessing and what that means and why we need to do that. And I said, that's right, because if we don't witness and we don't talk about the time in our life that God changed everything about us and how our lives changed from Kronos to Kairos and they became important each and every moment, then who's going to tell them? Because you know who will tell them? The world's a lot better at doing those things than we are. It's on television each and every day. If you don't do this, something's going to happen to you. If you don't take the time to read this or seek this out, this is what will happen. I heard a while back when I was younger, a young man who had been involved in the gang system in California give a speech. And he talked about his faith and how it had changed his life. And he talked about the time periods of life that he had gone through. And there was one thing that he said that really stuck out to me and to many other preachers and youth ministers that were sitting there. He said, if you don't know how, as a person of faith, to share time with someone else about that time that Jesus changed your life, then the world will do it for you. And he said, no one does it better. Not even the churches, not even families, than our gangs that we have in the world. They know how to go to the person and say, feel this closeness that we have, this brotherhood. Embrace the things that we're doing. And if you share in this, then you'll be connected to us forever. And it's something that young people seek out. That's all they want to feel, is connected to something. And the gangs reach out and do that. And there you go. The next thing you have it is you have another child that's lost. And we got to pray them back in. We don't do as good a job at the church as we should have of reaching those kids and pulling them back into what they need to hear. We do a great job when they're younger. We get them up here and we have them sing. We get them up here and we have them have youth group. We get them up here and we teach them in Sunday school. We have small groups for them, all kinds of things. And then the next thing you know, they head off to college and the real world hits them and they get some kind of professor that wants to twist them all up and talks about things that they'd never heard of before. And the next thing you know, they're calling home and saying, how come you never told me this, Mom or Dad? And you say, well, I wanted you to hear the good things about faith and life. And the next thing you know, we've lost another young person. And then what we have to do is keep praying that they come back as they get older. The Bible says that if we raise them up in the times that we have, then even if they turn away, they can come back. But how often do they? Not just looking in our church, but looking in all churches at this moment. If as Central Trinity, we decided, okay, for the next month, we're going to divide up our congregation into groups of like 20 or so, and I'm going to assign to you four churches that I want your group to go to in the next month. And instead of having our own church, you go to these churches. And if you did, I guarantee you, you'd see the same thing that you see in here, which is a certain group of people with other groups of people missing. And what does that mean? Well, it means that time is passing us by. It means that times are changing. It means that those kairos moments that God gives us, they're being hidden. I read to you just a few moments ago in Ephesians there, 5:13, and the first verse is there on the screen. It says, everything exposed by the light becomes visible. You may have heard that and thought, well, what does that have to do with time, John? Well, this is what it has to do. In the Greek, ta panta is all things. In this instance, that all things, that everything, is referring to those things that are in your life and my life that are secret and hidden that no one else knows. It's the parts of us deep down that nobody else sees. And what Paul's writing here is he's saying, but the light shines on everything, all things, and it illuminates all of them. Well, I don't know about you, but there's some things in my life that I wouldn't want illuminated. There's things that I've done or said or did that I wouldn't want to come out into the light. But God says we must bring them into the light because He is the light. And when we expose the darkness to the light, we can turn that darkness into light. We can take that moment of the child that we've lost and we can put the light back on them. And there's a chance that they'll come back into the light and escape the darkness. There's a chance that we might too. Odds are in a group this big, if you read some of the studies that George Barna has put out over the years, there's always in a group of over 100 or so, one or two people that are in that church or congregation and in that darkness of just their normal everyday life. There's something pretty dark that they're keeping secret from everybody else. But I'm here to tell you that there's something probably all of us are keeping secret. We know this. We know that the Bible says that all sin is the same. It's equal in God's eyes. So it doesn't matter if it's a big one or a little one. It doesn't matter if it's a visible sin that you can see or one that's hidden. It's still darkness. And Paul's writing here and he's saying, let God shine the light, because evil will try to avoid it, but the light will bring everything into the light. Verse 14 there, the next one says, let the light of divine truth wake you up. It's saying, wake up, sleeper, rise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you. This is in parentheses. I read it a few different places, and it said it could be partly some of it from Revelation where it says, arise, O sleeper. It could be from someplace else, but more than likely it's probably in some type of hymn that they sang back then that sang, sleeper, rise. And what the word sleeper there means is it means the one who's in the dark. Because we don't sleep in the light, do we? Those that do, well, those are the ones that work on third shift, right? They get their days and their nights all mixed up. And you watch those people. It takes forever for them to get into a rhythm. You know why? Because we are creatures that are designed to be in the light when we're awake and in the dark when we're asleep. And if we're not in the dark when we're asleep, and there's other lights that are glowing and flickering, it bothers the rhythm of our bodies, and we don't sleep very well, do we? Those of you that do this know this, because you probably sleep with the television on, maybe not the volume, just the flickering of the pictures. That warmth of the extra light makes you feel better, and you go to sleep. But actually, there's proven studies that that light, the different parts of that light that's coming at you, is not the same kind of light that you think of. And it's detrimental to you. Nowadays, though, they have other lights, right? They tell you to put these on at night. There's the Himalayan salt rock or whatever the heck that thing is, right? It gives off some certain kind of light. You plug it in, you put it in your little wall socket there, or it'll light up, or you plug it in, right? Anybody have one of those? It gives off an interesting light. There's also these things that the kids love now, which are these little lamps. And they create different lights. My kids have them. They create like a sunset kind of a light. So my son, when he goes to sleep at night, because he's still kind of has issues with the dark, like all 12-year-olds sometimes do, he's got some type of light on. And right now, he's got that sunset light on. So when you walk into his room, it's like you're looking out over the ocean and there's some type of sunset in there, and you think to yourself, how in the world are you going to sleep in the middle of this? But you know what? I don't always like to go to sleep in the dark either. My wife hates that about me because she likes it to be pitch black. You want to know why? Because she doesn't get up to go to the bathroom 20 times in the middle of the night, so she doesn't care. I'm a man, I have a prostate, and so I have issues. And so my favorite thing is I have a little tiny light that glows just a little bit orange in the bathroom so that I can at least see where it is that I'm going. Otherwise, I have other problems, like I'm peeing in the middle of the night in the trash can or something. It's happened. Don't laugh. Your preacher's human. But what happens, you see, is that's what it's designed for. Nighttime is darkness. It's designed for that. Light time is designed for us to do things in the light. Catching it? Because who's in the light? He is in the light. And as he's in the light, he brings us into the light. And so we're told to wake up because the light's passing us by. If you go to those next two verses to finish that off, it's something very similar. If you go to 15 there. John, can you go to 15? Sorry. Be very careful then how you live, not as unwise, but as wise, meaning apply your time each and every day to the light. And then the last verse says this, making the most of every opportunity because the days are evil. Now, what does that mean? I read that to someone this week, asking them what they thought, because I like sometimes to get ideas before I talk about it. And they said, I don't know. Does that mean that each and every day is evil, really, like it says? And I said, no. What it means is that the devil knows the rhythm of what we are. He knows that the dark is where he does his better work. And so what he's done is he's begun to take over parts of the daytime and the light. And so each and every day has a chance for evil to touch you if you don't constantly focus that light in on all parts of you. And you know what that's like, right? It's like, say, for instance, you were living with just candlelight for a month. Everywhere you went in your house was candlelight. And then you shined a spotlight at the end of that month in each and every room. What would you see? You'd see black on the walls and other things, right? Because candles make messes. You'd see things up in the corners that you couldn't see that weren't there, because even a light of a candle doesn't reach every part of it. It's why when we have Christmas Eve and we do our candlelight service, we all have candles, right? And we hold them high, right? Even though they're those little tiny battery operator ones. Not my favorite, but I understand why we do it. But we wave those. And it's not the same thing, right? Because it can't reach the corners. There's one thing that can, and that's that Kairos time of our Savior. Let me read you these verses from Romans as we close. See if you can catch the idea of God's voice of time. And Paul writes this, I consider that our present sufferings are not worth comparing with the glory that will be revealed in us. For the creation waits in eager expectation for the children of God to be revealed. For the creation was subjected to frustration, not by its own choice, but by the will of the one who subjected it, in hope that the creation itself will be liberated from its bondage to decay and brought into the freedom and glory of the children of God. We know that the whole creation has been groaning as the pains of childbirth right up to the present time. Not only so, but we ourselves who have the first fruits of the Spirit grown inwardly as we wait eagerly for our adoption to sonship, the redemption of our bodies. For in this hope we were saved. But hope that is seen is no hope at all. Who hopes for what they already have? But if we hope for what we do not yet have, we wait for it patiently. In the same way, the Spirit helps us in our weaknesses. We do not know what we ought to pray for, but the Spirit Himself intercedes for us through wordless groans. And He who searches our hearts knows the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for God's people in accordance with the will of God. And it ends with this: and we know that in all things God works for the good of those who love Him, who have been called according to His purpose. What is your purpose? You've been called to it. The light is calling out to you. It's why in church we leave the one flickering light in the sanctuary. Never goes out unless there's no electric. Then it does go out, because that's the world that we live in, right? But in you, you have the opportunity to have your light and keep it going again and again, time after time, minute after minute, month after month, day after day. And if you keep that light going, others will see that light and they'll wonder, where did your light come from? And you can tell them, my light comes from the Lord, the one who created all things, including the light that you're drawn to even now. I love that Romans 8:28, because what it's saying is all things work for good. And people read that and they say, but why then is it so hard to be a Christian? And I tell them, well, you're missing part of it. You're thinking in Chronos time, not Kairos time. And Kairos time is this: all things work for good in God's time. Because if we are called, and if we are called according to His purpose, and we live in His light, then in God's time, what we ask for, what we pray for, what we seek for, what we hope for will happen. Because what good is hope if you know you're going to get it already? And hope is what makes us go. And so my hope for you is this day, that as you try to live in that light, may it be the true light that you're seeking, not the false light of a world that's trying to steer you in their direction, but the light of the one who loves you so much. And if you forget where that light comes from, just look up. Look up and say, Father, shine that light on me. Will you bow your heads with me? Heavenly Father, I thank you for our time that we can share together. May we hear God's voice as He calls out to each of us and says, help me shine that light. Help me shine that light in the places of the world where it's hard to reach unless someone goes there. Unless someone goes there and puts their light directly on it. I pray for those that do that, Father, but I also pray for those that just simply do that in each and every day in their Chronos, plain old time. They try to fill it with a little Kairos, with a little specialty, with a little special opportune moments. And Father, today we give all those moments to you. May you help us be like Jesus and be the light of the world. It's in Christ's name that we pray. Amen.
Our closing hymn can be found on page 368, My Hope is Built. We will sing verses 1, 2, and 4. Would you please stand?
We each have a special moment as we go to be able to share that with whoever it is that we're going to see or meet this week. And as you go, may you go with that light of Christ with you. And remember that Kairos time. I know that life is full of the Kronos, but look for that Kairos time each and every week and each and every moment that you have this week. It was good to see you this morning.